Just in case no one told you lately, I believe in you. I see you as you are. I bow down to your divinity. I love that you don't give up easily. And I could watch your eyes for a moment and write down the 10,000 points that you carry in those eyes. I honor your stories. I honor your patience. I am Chandresh Bhardwaj, and this is Break the Norms. Namaste everyone, I hope you're doing well. Quick announcements before we begin today's topic of which. First announcement that people in United States and Canada can now text me directly and also receive texting from me. I'll be using this service to share the life lessons, the meditation tips, anything that I feel the need to share on a more frequent basis. And the content I'll share on text messaging will remain on text messaging. I'm calling it Conscious Texting with CB. And the students in USA and Canada can use it for now. Hopefully it will expand beyond these two countries. The number is in show notes and you can use it to start texting. Second announcement is the Leela announcement. If you have not signed up on leelagurukul.com, I would highly recommend it because the applications will be opened in another few days. And this is going to be invite only to very selective students. And by selective, it means you will have to go through the application process. And the moment we reach the full limit of application, it will be closed for the season. And if you're not signed up on the email, you may not know it for a while. Because we are of course going to honor and respect those who signed up for Leela 6 months ago, because we promised all the sign up seekers that you will be the first one to know about the application, so they will be the first ones. And if you have not signed up, please do that today itself, and then the application process will be a bit easier for you. And now the topic for today, which it's an interesting topic, and I hope by the end of it you gain insight and information. And I believe maybe this topic is not for everyone who is not into this kind of work. This is definitely for, I would say, people who are curious, especially about the feminine energy, people who are curious about other sides of Tantra, people who are curious about knowing the deeper layers of chakra. And if you think that you are those, one of these people, definitely listen to it till the end. Because after I share the facts from Tantra, I will share my opinion on the whole universe of witches. Because most of this episode is going to be straight information from the Tantra scriptures. And, of course, I'll share bits and pieces about my experience. But a lot of this will be taken from Tantra because a topic like this needs the Tantra, support in many ways. And you'll know it when I start sharing about it. So relax and keep your heart open as we dive into the fascinating world of witches. I feel I need to share this story which really inspired me or woke me up to talk about this topic. So this happened a few months ago. I had given my car for service and I needed to pick up the car. It's only like 5 or 7 minutes away from my place, and but by car, not by walking, which means it could take 10 minutes on a traffic day. So I thought I'll call Uber and I'll just take the cab to the dealership, pick up my car, and it should be easy. I don't know if you know this about me or not, because I have shared this in a bunch of podcasts randomly. When I'm traveling, I do not share what I do. It's just something I've always done. I think there's such a strong part of me that loves my privacy, and I find it very exposed if I start sharing too much details about what I do, and just a lot of personal stuff. And it's just something I've always done. And I think also because my job description could also feel like an invitation to many people around to start sharing their journey. And I feel this is such a sacred work. And if I'm not in that energy space, it will not, lead to the healing or to the right response or right energy that I would want to share. Because majority of people, they want to know, or they want me to say things that they want to hear. And if, that's just how it usually unfolds, and that's not fun. That's just not the right play of energy. So I got this cab, I sat in it, and within 2 minutes, the person asked, what do you do? And usually most Uber drivers or cab drivers, they feel I am in IT because I am an Indian, and I play along. I tell them, oh, how do you know? They said, no, I know many Indian people here. They work in, Silicon Valley. They work in big IT companies. And I know if I'm dressed up really formally, they might think I'm a doctor, because that's another group of, Indian community who's doctor. So anyway, this person said, what do you do? And there are very few times in my life when I've revealed what I do, and I'm not proud of those moments mostly, because there are 95% of the time this work of mine shows up in a very organic way, and it shows up with people who need the help, and I continue to be grateful for that opportunity. But when my body, my emotions, my awareness tells me don't say it, and if I say it, then I just pay the price for it, basically, for not honoring my intuition. So this person asked, what do you do? And it was only 7 minute ride, and I was like, what could go wrong? Let me just say this is what I do. And I told him, my job label is, I started with very generic thing. I said, I talk about positivity, I talk about yoga, because most people understand this work through yoga and positive thinking. And then he said, oh really, that's interesting. And what does yoga include? And then I gave him a little extra detail about what I work. And I, he started asking questions about how do we connect with God in this work. And I shared with him that, in Tantra, we see everything as extension of divinity. So you are extension of divinity. I am extension of that divine energy, and we all are. And then I shared a few more things, and then I started seeing the uneasiness in him. And I was like, I can see my dealership from here. It's only 2 minutes. So maybe just 2 more minutes of this uneasiness, awkward, moments in the cab. And then I'm done, and he's done. And he can give me a lower rating, and we both can go happy in our own ways. But that didn't happen. We reached the dealership in 2 minutes. But by that time, he was very curious. And when you start something wrong, and then the chain builds up. So I kept on sharing more information. I have no idea why. Maybe because I needed to do this podcast. And he asked about the godliness in Tantra. He asked about other things. And then I happened to share how the feminine is honored so strongly in Tantra, and we honor the feminine energy in men, in women, and in every living being out there, because without feminine, the healing doesn't happen, the growth doesn't happen in anything. And he said, what kind of feminine energy? I mean, how do you define that feminine energy? And I started defining the traits of the goddesses, the traits of the wild, strong, fierce woman. And the moment I started describing, he said, these are witches, and we don't need any witches in society anymore. And that was it for me. And I said, thank you for the ride. And just so you know, we need witches. I hope we can encourage them, we can enable them, and we help them to, you know, expand their wings. And I'm sure he gave me the lower rating in Uber because I don't take Uber so much. And whenever there was another driver many months ago, maybe 3-4 years ago, and he also happened to have the same conversation, and it made him very uneasy. And I remember my ratings dropped. So, you know, it's just how I figured he was just not happy. But he was very angry. He was probably angry with himself. He was angry with the idea of a strong feminine, and it was very visible. But I'm thankful to him because he sparked that fire in me that maybe there are more, you know, souls out there who are angry with themselves or who are angry with the strong feminine, and maybe they need to hear this. And I know there are many feminine out there who carry a very strong witch energy, but they're afraid to embrace, accept, and express that witch vibe. And I felt that maybe I need to do this for them also. And hopefully it will inspire and empower the feminine, the witch energy in many women out there. So this one will go through different layers of what we call witches, but it's going to be through the lens of Tantra, because it will be impossible, and I don't think I'm the right person to talk about the existence of witch in other cultures, other traditions, because I'm very familiar with the Eastern perspective on it, but vaguely familiar about others, and I feel the people from that culture should talk about it. So when I moved from India to New York, I realized there is a lot of negative branding. It was really a negative branding about the witches, and I saw in the name of religion, in the name of purity, women have been abused, tortured, and even killed. And the popular phrase of burn the witches, that's just, you know, a very tragic part of our history, and I really hope it doesn't happen anywhere right now. But I do know any woman who starts to embrace or honor that witch energy in herself, she is not welcomed or accepted in the most, you know, beautiful way. And many of them do leave their hometowns and they start to find that like-minded community. And unfortunately, many of them, end up being abused, or their vulnerability is taken for granted, and it does not go well in any direction. And it's sad. It's just very tragic that this happens, and the women who carry this unconventional energy in them, they have to go through a lot. And I do want to talk about certain ways of honoring this energy. And I do want to talk about how in Tantra, it's a very strong element of honoring and working with the witches. Now, Tantra and Hindu culture, it might be, as much as I know, it might be one of those very rare schools of spirituality where the witches are not only, embraced and honored and accepted, but there are ways to work with them in a very celebrating way and not in a very scary way. And as you all know, Tantra is a science, it is a technology, and it's always been very normal in the Eastern traditions to work with the witches. In fact, if you travel within the little towns and villages of India, you'll see each village has their own, you know, goddess. They have their own, and they won't call her a witch, because witch is really a very Western term, right? They would call her Devi. So they have their devis, they have their goddesses, and each village have either at least one goddess, and they have many ways to honor and activate and energize, you know, those goddess consciousness energies. There are ways in the, you know, in many towns and villages where the little girls are, you know, symbolic of that goddess energy, and they are honored, they are, you know, they are seen as that symbolic energy of the Devi or the witches. In fact, you know, whenever Navratri happens, Navratri is the nine nights of divine feminine celebration. Whenever that happens, the little girls in our own spiritual center in New York, we honor them. We honor the goddess in them by just, you know, giving them gifts, by, you know, having them sit in the meditation space and just taking their blessings, because that witch energy, that goddess energy can speak through the little children, the little girls in the most beautiful way. I remember, this is a few years ago, I was speaking at the 10 meditation in LA, and as always, there would always be just adults, right, in the room. And there was one day I really wanted to speak about the divine feminine, and there was a little girl there. I call her Miss Thea. So she was there, and it was my first meeting with her, and I really thanked her from the bottom of my heart, because I felt she was sent by the divine feminine to just bless, to just, you know, offer her grace, offer her, you know, unconditional energy to everyone. And I always tell her father that I'll never forget that. I even took a picture with her and I posted that on my Instagram. But you have to scroll back to 2 years or 3 years ago, I think. But these, you know, energies do have existence. And their existence is as old as humankind, as old as mankind. So they are not some modern new age idea. They've always been there. There are a few problems that I want to discuss, you know, before I go into the deeper explanation about, you know, how to tap into their energy, how to work with their energy. The first problem that I see, and I do want to address it, is the, you know, cultural appropriation with the work of witches, because I think it is a very sensitive, highly sensitive work, highly sacred work. And when people on social media do not understand the seriousness, the sacredness of it, and they feel by dressing up or by doing a certain makeup and playing a certain music in the background and just sort of, you know, imitating that role could make things perfectly, you know, sacred, that does not happen, because this is highly sensitive work. Even to initiate yourself into this kind of work, you will be required to go through years of deep meditation. If you are gifted with this energy, even then you are going to be required to go through a lot of devotion, a lot of serious work. So I think the social media cultural appropriation is very disrespectful toward that. And if you listen to my, you know, episode on cultural appropriation, you know, I don't want to go through that same thing again. But if you are walking into it in a very innocent way, and you feel just by, you know, putting up a show of being a witch will be great, and you will honor the witch in you or around you, that's not how it works. And I would recommend pause yourself right there and, you know, invite yourself to explore this universe with, you know, curiosity. Study it, work with someone, and then you go into it. And by the time you go into the depth of this work, you'll realize it's never meant to be shared on social media in that way. But for that, you know, to go deeper into the cultural appropriation, I would recommend listening to the episode on it. Now, because see what happens, there is a lot of, you know, judgment associated with witchcraft or working with the witches or the goddesses in that way. And people would be uncomfortable. Many women would be uncomfortable coming out and accepting that this is their journey, because there is a lot of supernatural magic kind of work. There's a lot of occult work associated with it. A lot of belief systems are associated with it. So it's not something that's just, you know, very easy to slip into. And if you ask me, you know, what is what's the quality of a witch, I don't want to define a witch in any way, but I would say the quality of witch is that she is aware of her strength, aware of her, you know, strong energy, and there is a sense of wildness in her, and that wild energy again is not the wild energy that you see on Instagram. That wild energy is connection with the nature, connection with the earth. There is also strong moody energy, you know, that's part of the feminine energy. There is that moodiness, you know, that the mood, the emotions go through change, but there's also that motherly warmth, that loving energy, the energy of just taking care of you, you know, giving you healing, being there for you. And of course there is a dimension of occult in it, a little ritual. It's a ritual, but it feels like occult, and because, you know, we don't know the science and technology of these things, so all of this feels like some sort of magic, some sort of occultism happening. But it, if you ask me, it's really not occultism. It's just certain things and experiments in spirituality that we are not used to of seeing, so we start to feel that something is, you know, wrong happening. Now I want to bring in Tantra here, because what we are going to share has a lot of Tantra context, and I wanted to explain various witches through the lens of chakras, through the lens of Tantra, because I think that will be really exciting. Now Tantra, you know, in Tantra there's a word called Pashu. Those who understand Sanskrit or Hindi, you might think Pashu means animal, and it does mean animal, but the literal meaning of Pashu means someone who's conditioned, someone who's designed to stay that way. And that's why every animal, you know, stays that way for their entire life. If you have a cat and dog, they were born as, you know, a certain, you know, dog and cat, and they'll die as one. Same for all other animals. But if you look at a human being, a human baby is born in a certain way, but by the time they die, I mean, so much has evolved. You know, they have invented certain things, they have changed the world in certain ways. I mean, what a beautiful thing to be, you know, born as human consciousness. But the, you know, harsh truth is, the tragedy is, we do not honor that presence, that we don't honor the strength of this human consciousness. And that's why we continue to be self-destructive in many ways. So in Tantra, there is prime goddess Kali, right? Goddess Durga, goddess Lakshmi, and then there are Das Mahavidyas, the 10 goddesses in Tantra, but they would not come under what we would call a witch, but they would come under the prime goddesses. But there are certain specific goddesses which would come under the witch energy. And each of those energy, you could think of them as a junior staff, as a junior goddess to the prime goddesses. And many tantrics, many tantra practitioners go very deep into working with these witches, because their energy is very tangible, their energy is very strong, and they are activated in a very powerful way. But do listen to the entire podcast. Either you stop here or you go until the end, because what I'm going to share is a sensitive information, and I was unsure if I even should be sharing it on podcast, but because there is so much judgment, and after hearing those words from the Uber driver, I felt I just need to share it, because there's a need for it. So the Tantra witches, or the junior goddesses, I mean, if that's even a word, but yeah, the junior goddesses in Tantra would be Dakini, Rakini, Lakini, Kakini, Shakini, Hakini, Bhairavi, Yakshini, Yogini, Naika, Nagini, and Bhutani. So these are some of the most prime witches in Tantra traditions. And whenever women have been abused in the Eastern traditions in the past, or even in the modern India, they are abused using any of these names. But the Hindu tradition, the Tantra tradition, do not see these names as wrong or as any, you know, disrespectful. They are absolutely honored on a very, very high scale. In fact, whenever we indulge in any Tantra rituals, we honor each of these witches and goddesses in our, you know, rituals. So I'm letting you know, you might hear these names in a negative sense, but that's just the same tragedy as you would hear about burn the witches. So in Indian traditions, some people may use these names to just project a very negative sense, but it's, you know, not. And the first witch, Dakini, and I think this is also a name that's very popular in the Western spirituality. She is the goddess of the Muladhara Chakra, the root chakra. The mantra for this chakra is Lam. And there is a very powerful text called Rudrayamal Tantra. It's filled with some of the most powerful gems about the Devi consciousness, about Shiva and Shakti. In the Rudrayamal Tantra, they describe the Dakini goddess, the Dakini witch, as a very peaceful, very happy and joyful energy. And her energy is so joyful that she attracts a lot of love. She attracts a lot of good things in life. And one of her prime qualities is that she indulges in experiences with awareness. She indulges in life with absolute awareness. And when you meditate on the Muladhara Chakra, and when you use the mantra Lam, you can invite a very soft, gentle, happy, playful form of the Dakini goddess. And she's also a very prime energy of good health, mental well-being, a stronger foundation of who you are. And there's so much written about her in the Rudrayamal Tantra. But for you to understand the context in the chakra meditation, the mantra will remain the same, Lam, and her energy is really the energy of joy, happiness, a very expansive aura, and very much, she attracts a lot of good energy. The second witch is Rakini. Rakini is a Shakti, divine feminine energy, and she is the Shakti, the energy of Swadhisthan Chakra or Sacral Chakra, right above the root, right above the Muladhara. Her mantra is Vam. Her energy is very relaxed. Like you could imagine in the Rudrayamal Tantra, they describe her as someone who's just floating effortlessly in an ocean. There is playfulness in her energy, but also there's a lot of compassion, a lot of, giving energy. She would take in your, doubts, your pain, your worries. And her energy is described as someone who would make everyone happy, who would take away your suffering, who would take away your struggle with your goals, and she will bring you abundance. She will bring you a very healing, deeper, energy. And I feel Rakini or the Sacral Chakra energy is such a powerful energy for anyone who is struggling with any doubt, any fear, any struggle with their career. And third one is Lakini, the third witch, Lakini, and her energy is on Manipur Chakra or Solar Plexus Chakra. The mantra is Ram. And in Rudrayamal Tantra, they describe her as someone who is filled with love, pure love. And she will multiply the strength of your mind. She will expand the strength of your mind. And people with ethics, people with strong principles, she loves those energies. People who are very ethical, people who stand by their, voice, people who stand up for what is not right, and people who stand up, to make things right. And she's also someone who will indulge in the sensual pleasures of life with complete awareness and not impulsively. Her energy is extremely mystical, very much expanding everywhere, very wise energy, and the energy who will differentiate between good and bad, right and wrong. And if you are struggling with any guilt, any suffering, this is the energy to meditate on. Fourth one is Kakini. Her energy is energy on Anahata or Heart Chakra. The mantra for Kakini is Yam. And in the Rudramal Tantra, they say, this is a beautiful description of the goddess Kakini. The Tantra work says that before you become ready to receive her energy, first meditate on that higher consciousness and connect the higher consciousness or that divine consciousness with the Kakini goddess. And after that, honor goddess Kali, connect with goddess Kali, and then invite the energy of goddess Kakini. Her energy is very soft, very gentle, very strong and fierce also. You know, anyone who's messing with you, any, you know, negativity, any anger, any crazy energy around you, she'll protect you from that. Her aura is yellow, strong gold aura, very, you know, strong in her energy, very strong in her principles. And she is someone who is also very connected with that divine consciousness, the, you know, what we call that higher divinity, the godliness. She is definitely part of that. So very divine, sacred one. Next one is Shakini. Shakini is connected with the Vishuddha chakra or the throat chakra. The mantra is Hum. And in the Rudramal Tantra, they say that her energy is very electric. You know, in the Tantra, they describe her so beautifully. They say, as if millions of the moons, you know, they, you know, rise together. That's her aura. And she's also strongly connected to goddess Kamakhya, who is a very, very, very profound and very prime goddess in Tantra. She's the goddess where, you know, we honor the yoni, the root energy of the goddess. And she's described as one of the most beautiful energy. And her energy is deep, infinite, and wisdom. You know, she'll invite the teachings, the information, the, you know, enlightenment in you that you didn't know existed in you. So her energy is extremely mystical, extremely, you know, in a supernatural way out there. Next goddess, next witch is Hakini. Hakini is connected with Agya Chakra. And these goddesses, by the way, are very strongly connected with the awakening of Kundalini. So if you go deeper into the Kundalini work, each of these witches, each of these, you know, goddess energies are very strongly recommended to meditate on. And Hakini goddess is the goddess of third eye, Agya Chakra. And as you meditate on Hakini, it's recommended that you become very clear in your intentions. You become very clear in what you want and what you don't want. Her energy does, you know, starts to connect you with the other dimensions out there. Her energy starts to connect you with other strong, powerful energies out there. So by the time you reach the Agya Chakra goddess, you will start to experience and, you know, visualize things which are very strong, very, you know, something that belongs to just other dimensions that you cannot explain, you know, well, or cannot explain deeply. And then there are other goddesses, which is, you know, kind of out of scope for the podcast purpose, but I'll tell you one thing. Among all the other goddesses, two goddesses I want to mention, Bhairavi and Yogini. Bhairavi, because Bhairavi is a very higher, you know, status of a witch or a goddess, and her reference in Tantra comes in many, you know, spots. In fact, the, you know, scripture Vigyan Bhairav Tantra is based upon the conversation between Shiva and Bhairavi, his partner. In the other, you know, schools of Tantra, her energy is seen as the energy of the guru, energy of the healer. And you would not hear about many female gurus, right? So her Bhairavi form of the goddess and the witch is seen as the guru form. Very, very higher status work. In another, you know, way, her energy is seen as the Shri Vidya, the Tripura Bhairavi, Tripura Sundari, Lalita Tripura Sundari. So her Bhairavi is a goddess that I think if you want to truly devote into Tantra work, Bhairavi's work is very, very powerful, extremely deep. And the other one is Yogini. And I'm mentioning Yogini because Yogini is also understood as the one who practices yoga. So the female, yoga practitioner would be called Yogini. But in Tantra context, there are 64 specific Yoginis. And, they all have different purposes. They all have different, chakra connection, kundalini connection. If I go deeper into everything, this would be like a 10-hour, podcast. But I hope in Leela, we could go deeper into this work. But I wanted to give you context of the witches, and because they are honored, loved, and treated with a lot of respect, a lot of devotion in Tantra. And if you have been holding back any witch in you or around you, do not hold back that energy, because it's the energy that deserves to be out there. And now, I'll come to my opinion and how to tap into their energy in a deeper way. First of all, the work of witches is very sacred, highly sensitive. I know people who have experimented with witches. And because it's such a energetic work, right, it involves a lot of spiritual energy. So if you end up experimenting based on the books or online knowledge, you may end up messing up some, restless energies. And if they come, they'll come because you invited them, but they'll go when they want to. And I don't even want to go into the stories because that will scare you. You may not even be able to sleep. But I know people who have gone too deep and they have become too lost in that work because they have experimented with just, wrong energies in the wrong way. And it doesn't make the energy wrong. It could be the most sacred energy, but if you are simply playing with them casually, you are messing up with the wrong person, right? Now, let's say you want to begin working with them. Highly recommend to start building a very deep meditation practice. Highly recommend that you accept that it would take few years to even be decently comfortable with the witch energy. So be willing to invest few years of your life into this work. And then start being comfortable with beings who may not look like you. That's where the discomfort starts, because we live in such a shallow society that if there's a person who may not be of the usual two genders that we have, male or female, or if there's a human walking with a different body than you, maybe too skinny, maybe not too skinny, maybe more weight than you would consider to be the right weight. I mean, we body shame people. We are so terrible in dividing people in the name of religion, skin color, nationality. So the witch work will demand from you that you start honoring not just the humans around you, but when the real witch energy shows up, it will not be the most attractive energy. Because many Tantra practitioners literally create the witch energy that may not be attractive at all. They'll make, for the lack of a better word, they'll make her very unattractive. Because if she is very attractive, of course, there's possibility of being attracted sexually to them. But the witch work requires a very high discipline over your sexual energy. You cannot be sexually very weak. And by weak, I mean you cannot be sexually very impulsive or addicting, because that would ruin all the work you're doing. So you have to have a very high level of discipline with your sexual energy. You have to be comfortable to see energies and experience energies who may not look like humans, who may look a bit scary, a bit alien, but you have to be comfortable with them. You have to be very disciplined with your emotional energy. You cannot let your fear, your trauma be projected into the work assigned to you in this work. Because as you go deeper into this, you are inviting a very unconventional way of life. you may no longer be living for yourself. You will be serving others. The conventional relationships may not be for you. You may be misunderstood by others. And that's just something you have to accept, you know, about this life. And if I have a certain trauma or fear that's unresolved and I'm projecting that on other humans, then I'm not ready to move into the witchcraft work. And that's why a deeper sadhana work with a qualified teacher is highly recommended. And my opinion is, do not get involved until you are willing to invest the next few years of your life into this. Because once you get involved, it's a new universe. It is a new planet you're walking into. So you have to learn that language. You have to learn how to let go of the attachments that you have. But it is a rewarding work for the chosen ones, you know, who are chosen to do this work, who are chosen to heal the world through this witch energy. And those who are listening, and if you're feeling the spark, the emotion, the intensity of the witch energy within you and around you, I bow down to you. I really do. And I truly feel you, you know, multiply your fire and you heal the world with your most beautiful, fierce, unconventional, wild energy. My love and strength is with you. Thank you for listening to this long talk, and I hope it was helpful in any way possible. Thank you. I hope this podcast may travel through the untapped universe of your darkness, light, courage, passion, and so much more. Please do subscribe and be ready to break your norms. I am so excited and very honored to be part of your sacred journey through this podcast.